ladies and gentlemen. My name is Brett Keane from God TV Radio. Make sure you check out my website, godtvradio.com. Connect with me on Facebook and Twitter. We have with us today Shanny4Christ. Do you still have the same YouTube channel, Shanny4Christ?
Yes, I do.
All right, so folks, make sure you go over and subscribe, comment, rate. Can you spell it out for them in case they're like, huh, what?
Oh, it's Shanny, S-H-A-N-N-Y, 4, F-O-R, Christ, C-H-R-I-S-T.
Very good, very good. All right, the first question is, how long have you been a Christian?
It is coming up to now 5 years on Mother's Day.
All right, what inspired you? Did someone take you to church, or did you just decide to initiate it? How did this work?
I met Jesus. Something really bad and personal happened to my life, and I just wanted to die. So I did, literally wanted to die. I didn't have anything in my life left. And I was like a week away of converting to Wicca, and for some reason in my head I wanted to find a Bible because I just felt so bad, and I knew like Psalms, you know, had things that were comforting, and I wanted to find some kind of Psalms to read. So I spent 3 hours looking for my Bible, you know, on my bookshelf. You know, there's, like, Wicca books everywhere, and they're, like, on the bottom shelf in the, like, corner was this beautiful Bible. I still have it today. And I opened it up, and I started reading it for, like, 4 days. I stopped eating completely, so it was, like, four days of not eating, not drinking, and reading the Bible, and, you know, the brink of death, wanting to die, and ended up eating that night when I found Christ, and I was just, I watched this one video, what was it, an ex-Satanist on YouTube by Stephen Dollins. It's like the Prophecy Club, and I saw that, then I went to go take a shower, and then something strange happened. I went, boom, right on my knees, and I could not get up. I could not move, and I just started weeping uncontrollably, and I was like, Lord, if you could help me, if you could get what I need back, please, I will do anything. I will be your servant until the day I die. And then Jesus appeared to me, and I saw his feet, and I started kissing his feet and thanking him. And then I felt the Holy Spirit enter me, and it felt like a warm blanket because the water was just ice cold then, completely ice cold, and I was shivering and crying in the bathtub. And my husband came in, and he saw me actually being converted to Jesus, you know, and I was a staunch atheist, you know, I hated God. He was the last one I would seek out, you know, above anything. I'd rather do Buddhism than that. And then I found him, and ever since then, everything's been clicking into place.
Why do you think it is that you hated God before this?
Christians. Hypocritical Christians, their judgmental attitudes, and the fact that they really don't care for the lost, and they always judged people on what they did and what they said, and it just, it affected me really bad.
If it's not too personal, you can pass on any questions, but what did some Christians do to you that you considered so bad that it caused you to hate God?
Well, the first one was on Mother's Day when I was 13. I went to a Southern Baptist church, and they were talking about how, and I thought it was just completely inappropriate for Mother's Day. They were talking about how if a man wants to have his wife, she should obey him and give herself to him, even if she doesn't want to. And, you know, if she doesn't continue to give herself to him, then the man should force himself upon her. And this is a Southern Baptist church that was in, like, Asheville, North Carolina. And ever since then, I started looking for different avenues because I knew that wasn't what Jesus wanted, because I used to be obsessed with Matthew, the book of Matthew when I was around 13. You know, obsessed. I read it over and over and over and over and over again. So I had the Sermon on the Mount stuck in my head for years. Other reasons was, you know, going online and being a believer. It's actually, it was between you, TJ, Dick Coughlin, and Napalm that actually made me want to change over to atheism, to tell you the truth, to finally have the nail in the coffin. Before then, I had a Buddhist Jew. I was labeled myself as a Buddhist Jew for Jesus.
What would you say if I were to tell you that in my interview with The Amazing Atheist, one of my last questions was, do you believe that it's possible that God could exist? He actually said yes. How do you feel about that?
Praise God for that. You know, it's about dang time that he finds that possibility. But then again, he did say he prayed to God when his father died. So I hope he gets better than what he was, because I haven't watched him in years because of certain erratic behavior he had toward me.
I got to ask you, you said that I was one of the people that you watched whenever you were influenced to be an atheist. Out of all the assholes and idiots on the internet, why this asshole idiot did you watch? And I'm talking about myself. I said, out of all the assholes and idiot atheists you could have watched, why did you watch me for?
Because you're the grandfather daddy of atheism on YouTube.
Ooh, I never heard it put that way before.
You are. You're the one who started it, Brett. You started it all. And, you know, at the time, I just didn't feel like I had the maturity to understand it. But, I mean, I looked up to you because, you know, I started watching The Amazing Atheist. I don't even remember how I started watching him. I just started watching him. And he started talking about Dick Coughlin, so I looked into him, and Dick Coughlin always talked to Napalm, and I started hearing him, and then Napalm started mentioning you, and I was already watching you, but I don't even know how it all started. I just, you know, back 10 years ago, but it did.
Okay. You had said that before you went up into the bathroom and fell to your knees and your husband came up to witness your conversion, you said that you felt like you were going to die. Is it too personal to ask this? Why?
Sort of embarrassing. But I guess I'll answer it because it is part of my testimony. Back in 2010, I had a suicide attempt, because my husband now, he asked me to marry him, and I was just so freaked out because of my last marriage, that I was like, I can't do this, I don't know how to do this, and I freaked out, and for some reason, I cut my arms all up, and the police showed up, and took my sons away from me, and that was a horrible, horrible 2 years of my life because I had to go with CPS, taking my kids for 2 years because of a suicide attempt. And, but God got me through it the whole time, you know, even though I didn't have him when I initially lost my sons. But they're fine now.
You did end up getting your children back?
Oh, yeah. They realized how my background was, how it was abusive and stuff. And, you know, I had a couple of suicide attempts before then. But now it's so much better. I haven't cut myself in over 5 years now. I haven't had suicide attempts in over 5 years now. I've gone through extensive dialectic behavioral therapy, which basically is showing you a different way and showing you and teaching you how to cope through your life.
Has believing in God helped you?
It helped me more than the therapy, to tell you the truth. Jesus, he gave me the strength and will to survive. Like, for instance, like when I felt as an atheist, I didn't have anyone. But as a Christian, when you're alone, you have someone to talk to. You have God to talk to. And you have him to comfort you. And he's the greatest of all comforters.
I have another question for you. Are you aware, and this is something I actually brought up to Paul's Ego as well as the Amazing Atheist and some of my other people that I interviewed, but according to statistics, atheists have the highest substance abuse rates as well as suicide rates. Does that surprise you?
No, it doesn't.
Why do you think that
is? It doesn't at all. Very sad. They have no hope. What do they have to hope for? You know, it's like things happen, you end up dead. That's it. Death. Done. Over. Game over. That's how it is being an atheist. You know, versus being a believer and you have someone. You have something to hold on to. Even at your very worst, you have something still to hold on to.
Without God, can there possibly be a meaning or purpose in someone's life? Something beyond just imagining up something. Without God, is there meaning and purpose to the universe?
Oh, that's a tough one. I think people find purposes for their life when they don't have God, you know, be it their children or their mom or dad, but they look for human beings to cling to as an atheist. I don't know. You would have to ask an atheist what the purpose, if there is a true purpose, because I think everyone has like an individual answer to that.
When we can see that there are Christians out there as well as non-believers in society that will let us down, what do you do whenever humans let you down and at the same time you don't believe there's a God to talk to? What then?
I don't know. I would have been dead by then. I would have committed suicide. If it wasn't for God, I would have committed suicide by now.
Well, I'm glad that you did, and I'm glad you're here with me today.
Thank you.
All right. What do you think would be the hardest thing for you to give up on?
Oh. Other than God, my husband. I can't quit him. He's such a wonderful person. And then I can't quit on my kids either. I also can't quit. For some reason, I can't quit YouTube. I've been doing it for so long. It's just like, I can't do it. I can't stop it. It's going to be who it is.
Yeah, YouTube's become a virtual jungle. It's hard to survive in this treachery.
Well, I don't know. It's like you do it for 10 years, a whole decade of you on YouTube, and you're like, how can I stop this? You know?
I hear you. This next question is going to be a little weird, but would you give a homeless person CPR if they were dying?
I was homeless, so yeah. I've opened up my home to homeless people before.
You yourself was homeless?
2 years back. I had a really bad problem with bed bugs. They're really bad in this area. And my mother invited me to live at her house for a couple weeks so we could save up so we can get another place to live. She ended up kicking us out, so we ended up in a homeless shelter, which I don't regret, because that's when my life and how I viewed people and how my behavior toward people changed. Because a lot of the times how people act on the internet, it won't do in a situation in the real world. Like, if you're going to go in someone's face and tell them they should believe this and they should believe that, or they're going to die in hell, you're going to get your butt kicked for that.
All right, my next question is, what makes you bored?
What makes me bored? I don't know, I always seem to do something to take up time, but probably when no one's in the house and I don't have anything to take care of or anyone to take care of, that usually gets me bored.
You feel like you gotta constantly be moving, be distracted?
Oh yeah.
All right. Which is your favorite four-legged creature and why?
Cats, man. I love cats. I love their attitudes. I love how silly they can be. You know, I love how they talk to you and they comfort you. I love cats. If I could be any animal, it would be a cat.
Is there something or someone you miss the most from your childhood?
I miss my brothers. I'm no longer in contact with them. I miss them terribly. Because I helped raise them. And I look at them as my sons. And I just...
Do you have any way to contact them?
I stopped my relationship with them, so...
Do you have any way to contact them?
I do, but they don't want to talk to me because of my mom, because of how she's, I don't know what's wrong with her, but she told a bunch of lies about me that weren't true, and they don't want to have anything to do with me.
I wouldn't give up on that.
I was working for a company, and my brother went through and went to the company, and you know, I tried to talk to him and he wouldn't have it. So, and this was about 5 months ago. So I don't think there's any way there could be any reconciliation. Which is heartbreaking, because when you lose everyone in your family, it changes you and warps you as a person.
This next question, I don't know where this is going to go, but are you happy with your life for the most part right now?
Yes. For the most part, I do love how my life is. I have a house now. My children are very happy. Speaking of child, you were supposed to stay in your room, son. Go. You want a glass of milk? You'll get a glass of milk after this, okay, sweetie? Sorry about that. Yeah, I am actually very happy with my life. I have a wonderful husband. I have a wonderful cat who adores me, who's acting strange right now. I have a wonderful job. Nice car, nice, you know, I guess. I'm computerless at the moment, but other than that, I do really enjoy my life, and I actually enjoy solitude.
Okay. You can have one of the following of two things. You can either have trust or love with people. Which would it be?
Love. Love. If I could, like, one of my mantras back in my atheist day was, I just want people to love me. Hasn't changed. I still want people to love me.
All right. The next question I got for you is, tell me about your favorite book or magazine or comic.
Well, my favorite book's the Bible. I've read so many times. You know, it's a book where it tells you about the origin of man, how man speaks, how man thinks. You know, it tells you everything about mankind. It just, I don't know, it just, it's the greatest influence of my life.
Tell me about someone you envy.
I don't envy anyone, actually. There's no one I really, I mean, there's people I like, but I don't envy anyone, you know, because if they have success, I'm happy for their success. Because I think instead of envying someone, I think it's better to be happy for someone who has, you know, a good life. Because when you go down the track of envying someone, it tends to put a bitterness in your heart and a hatred in your heart toward that person, and it's not right to do, because it ends up destroying you at the end of the day.
Okay. Tell me something that you've achieved.
Probably this house is, like, my biggest achievement. You know, my roof on my old place that I had previously to this house just completely collapsed. And I called up my landlord and I was like, dude, you have to do something. My roof has completely collapsed. I can't live in here. There's no safety in here. And then, you know, he was like, wait. Because I also was like, dude, I'm going to go to the health inspector because I can't live here no more. And because of that, like, I don't know how I negotiated it. But because of the negotiation skills, I ended up getting a huge 3-bedroom house instead of a apartment. And now we have the option to buy this place, and we're going through the process of buying this place. I ended up bringing our rent down from $980 a month to $700 a month. So, I mean, that is a huge discount that I did. And it's all through negotiation skills that I was doing with him back and forth, my landlord. So that's, like, one of my biggest achievements. I think another huge achievement for me was the day I decided that I wanted to work, because I got in such a big depression a year, 2 years ago, it was about, I say a year and a half long depression where I refused to get out of bed and refused to do anything with my life because I lost my parents. I lost my brother and my brothers and sister. They stole my cat from me, my cat that I had for 11 years, Keiko. And I ended up in a homeless shelter. I mean, my whole life, just like Job, just completely just snatched away from me. And because of that, I ended up getting in depression. But I think one of my greatest achievements is I remember just sitting there and crying in the dark. My sons were at school at the time. And I was like, you know what? I can't do this to myself anymore. I got to get myself a life. I got to get myself a job. And I ended up applying to a job. It was so funny. It's like I walked in and got offered the job as soon as I walked in. And I ended up working there. And then I ended up changing to the job I have now, which is a lot better because I'm working with vulnerable adults and, you know, dealing with what I like the most is psychology. So I'm dealing with that right now. And I think that's like one of my other biggest achievements is pulling myself literally out of a depression, a bedridden depression.
All right.
And ended up finding happiness in life and being content, even though you can, I know some people, it's horrifying knowing just one day you can lose your whole family and it can completely destroy you. But you can survive it. You just have to realize that it's what life is, and you just have to learn to find that contentment inside of you to make yourself happy again. You have to find happiness because happiness is more than just an emotion. It's an idea and a place you have to be. You have to make yourself happy.
All right, I'm going to stop the recording. All right, can you tell me about the worst punishment you've ever had when you were a child?
Oh, gosh. The worst punishment. I think it was when I was 14. I know this is embarrassing, but I lost my virginity at 14, and I ended up telling my mom, and she ended up blowing up at me and beating me up and throwing me on her bathroom floor and continuing to beat me for about 3 hours. I think that was my worst punishment. And then after that, she refused to let me leave the house for about, since she abandoned us when I was 16, I guess. She would not allow me to go to friends' houses or anything because of that. She made me break up with my boyfriend. She even moved us out of the area because of it. And a lot of times she ruined a lot of friendships after that, even if they were female.
Why do you think that she treated you so poorly over this?
Personally, I think I was one of those children that she wanted to get aborted. And I think she's always held a grudge against me because she didn't abort me. That's my theory. I also think she's a very sick woman who's been untreated with a mental illness that's been going on for years, and she refuses to get it treated.
You got some kind of ringer going on?
Yeah, sorry. Let me see if I can fix that. Let me see if I can turn off notifications. There we go. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. Yeah, I turned all the notifications off. All Sorry right. about that.
Do you hold any resentment for her for putting forth this concept that she wanted to abort?
Yes, I have to say there's a deep-seated resentment for it, because it's like your mom wants to murder you and wanted to murder you. How I mean, I forgive her, but at the same time, I'd never have anything to do with her or trust her again after she did the last thing she did, because I'm not willing to risk myself or my family again like that.
Your volume, for some reason, has gotten a little bit quieter.
Sorry about that.
You're better now. I could hear you. It's just you got quieter.
Yeah.
All right. Let's try a more upbeat type of question. Do you prefer rainy days or snowy winter days?
Rainy, of course. I hate driving in the snow. It's the worst thing in the world, which I'm afraid of doing today because I'm getting in the forecast snow for tonight. So after I get out of work, I'm going to have to drive through all that snow.
All right. Name three things in nature that you find beautiful.
I know it's going to sound weird, but I love looking at weeds. I love a yard that is grown out. I think that's beautiful. I love looking up at the sky and seeing the clouds or the stars. I forgot to say, one of my favorite things in the whole entire world with nature is just watching squirrels run around.
All right, another rough one. What is the hardest thing you've ever had to do?
What's the hardest thing I had to do?
Ever had to do.
Getting over my family like I did. Like I said, that depression that I had after that, it was the hardest thing. I don't wish that type of pain onto anyone. I don't want anyone to ever have that type of pain because it's the worst type of pain you could ever have. I'd rather have physical pain. You know, I'd rather have someone stab me in the stomach. To tell you the truth, than that type of emotional pain. It's terrible to go through, but I'm a lot stronger now because I've gone through it. And, you know, a lot of my past behavior on the internet was because I was dealing with that pain, and it was just like even the littlest of something just set me off because I was just that sad and miserable.
All right, this next question is also a bit tough. What scares you the most and why? Remember, you can always pass on questions if it's too personal.
The dark. I hate the dark. It's, you know, you see shadows and stuff in the dark and you don't know what they are. You know, I guess the fear of unknown in the dark. I hate the dark. I refuse to be in the dark. I have to sleep with the light on or a TV on or something on that puts light in the room where I can see it at all times.
Why do you think it is that you're afraid of the dark?
Because I've seen things in the dark. I've seen ghosts. And I don't like seeing them, so I like have this constant fear of seeing them, because when it's dark, that's when you see them. You know, it all started at my husband's, or my ex-husband's house that we used to live in, and it was a three-tiered trailer,
and they put, and they bought, what I was told, it was bought, and it used to be a Indian burial ground. And then if you walk a little like further down the trails in the woods, you will see another burial ground, but this burial ground is from like the 1600s, and it's a child burial ground. And a lot of weird things happen in that house. You'd see shadow people, or you know, one of the most frightening things that ever happened to me was I woke up and I saw the shadow figure over me, and it touched me and freaked me the heck out. So ever since that happened and I had that experience, I never want to sleep in the dark again. I always like slept with the TV on or had some kind of light on or something.
Has any of these ghosts or entities that you've seen, have they ever showed up in the light?
No.
Okay. Have they ever spoken?
No. Well, yes. It was like, I don't know. It was like this. I was pregnant and I was lying in the bed, and it was like, convert to us or die. And I was like, no, I'll never be with you. And then, you know, I felt like, I don't know how this happened. I felt like a pulse in my like neck start throb like that, frightened the heck out of me. And yeah, it was weird. I have to say, I questioned my sanity at that time, but I really don't see, ever since I left my ex-husband and divorced him, I never seen anything like that since.
You were laying in the bed and you said you were pregnant?
Yeah, I was pregnant with my oldest.
Would it surprise you to know that I've asked religious people as well as non-believers, and many of them have stated that they've had what is referred to as night terrors, where they can't tell the difference, that they're either asleep or awake, and they see what you refer to as shadow figures or dark entities. Non-believers, of course, say they can't really explain why it is. They've just seen something like that. But, of course, religious people usually describe it as demons or spirits.
Definitely an evil feeling presence, I have to say.
Okay. Let's try a more upbeat question. Which is your favorite part of the human face and why?
The eyes, I guess. Because you can always see how someone's feeling through the eyes. Or, you know, if they're for you or against you through the eyes. The fact that some eyes look like my husband's eyes, for instance, to me, when I look inside them, it looks like looking at the universe. You know, the different colors and everything in eyes. Eyes are beautiful on the face.
All right, this next question is going to be a little bit more intense. Try to be as honest as possible or just pass on it. What is your favorite body part of the human body and why?
Does it have to be male, or does it have to be my body parts?
It can be male, or female body, just whatever you find is a favorite.
Female, definitely boobs. Don't know why. I love my boobs. Men, it's their shoulders and like the back of their shoulders too. I love that on a man.
Why do you think that is? I've heard women say that before. What's with the male back and shoulders?
It's like, especially when they're like wide and just, I don't know. It's like some kind of like, I guess it's kind of like some kind of instinctual sense of power or something. Like, I don't know. It's like, it's one of the most sexiest and luring things I can see on a guy. It's that region right there. It's like, I don't know. Like, when a man's, like, shoulder region's very, like, feminine looking, I it's a turn off. But when it's like, you know, man, oh yeah, I don't know why I like it. I don't know if it's like instinctual or if it's just like something I look at, but it's just like, it looks good to me.
All right, a little bit of a tougher question. Tell me about a mistake you've made.
I think my biggest mistake was how I've reacted to a lot of people on the internet and not taking the time to understand them, and not being patient enough to ask or answer their questions in a calm manner instead of letting my emotions get to me.
All right, next question. If you could do anything or wish for anything that would come true, what would you wish?
I'd love to win the lottery, to tell you the truth. You know, there's so many good things I could do if I won the lottery. You know, I'd buy myself a new car. I'd buy this house, definitely. But at the same time, even though I'd get some stuff for me, I would be doing a lot of things for the poor. Like, I was thinking about opening up a shelter for the poor in my area, even though we do have shelters here in my area. It's just a lot of them are overabundant with people, and they need more shelters in this area, so I would be working on building that. I would open up a woman's shelter for women. You know, you just need money to get those things done. You know, a food shelf, I would open that up, you know, and I would try to be helping as many people as possible with that money. Something rich men have the capability of doing, but they don't do. They'd rather hoard the money to themselves.
What music do you enjoy listening to?
I love the whole 60s, 70s genre of music, be it from like Pink Floyd to The Doors. You know, I love 60s music. I just love it.
All right. Yeah. Let's see, what is the last thing you ate, and what's your favorite food?
What was the last thing I ate? I don't know, I didn't eat anything today. I think it was a piece of orange pound cake that I made. But my favorite thing to eat is either between pizza or tacos. Probably more toward tacos. There's something about like that spice and the cheese and the lettuce and the tomatoes, just sour cream. That's just delicious to me.
All right. Would you consider yourself a person who enjoys shopping?
Yeah, I love to shop, you know. But when you have limited funds, you can't shop all the time. But if I could, I would. I'd be shopping all the time.
All right. How often do you go online?
Oh, I go online probably sporadically through the whole day. Through the whole day, sporadically. You know, with modern technology, the way it is, it's like you just go on your phone, you know, you get like a notification and you're like, oh, okay, what is this? You know, the only time I don't go on the phone or sporadically go on the internet is when I'm with or I'm at work or driving. But mostly throughout the day. I think that's pretty normal nowadays for people.
Okay. All right, my next question for you is, what's the one thing that you'd like to change about yourself?
Well, what I am working on right now is being more respectful, loving, and tolerant toward people. Any, like, creed, you know, nationality, sexual preference, it doesn't matter. I'm trying to be more loving and accepting toward them. That's what I'm working on right now.
What do you think the best phase in your life was?
My husband and children.
All right. My next question is what you're doing now what you always wanted to do growing up?
No. I wanted to travel, and I wanted to be famous, and, you know, I wanted to get into acting or music or something in my life, but that wasn't in the cards, so it's not that big of a deal, but, you know, it's not what I wanted to do, but I like how my life is turning out right now.
Sounds like somebody's popular.
I know, right? I'm so sorry.
Oh, God. What makes you feel accomplished?
Make me feel accomplished? Mm-hmm. I guess just having a goal and step-by-step achieving such a goal. I mean, it can be from anything, like from cooking to, you know, your work life. I mean, just go, at least trying to go towards your goals is a good achievement for me.
Okay. This next question is a bit on the rough side. Would you ever take back someone who cheated?
Depends. Like, I have to say, if my husband cheated, he wouldn't do it. But because how much I love him, and he wouldn't do it.
I'm not trying to put any weird ideas in your head. I'm just asking, what if someone...
But in past experiences, I have left every single person that did cheat on me. So, I guess, yeah, I mean, I know it would probably be hard for my husband, and I don't know. I would probably have to go through, like, some kind of, like, therapy or something, because I love that man so much.
All right, this next question is kind of a trust question. How do you feel about sharing your password with your partner?
Oh, he has it.
Okay, that pretty much takes care of that.
Yeah.
When do you think a person is ready for marriage?
Well, I had two marriages. One I was not ready for. I didn't want to marry him. I did it because I was told if I didn't marry him, then, this is my mom again, if I didn't marry him, then she would never speak to me again, and that frightened me, so I married him. When I married my husband now, though, the difference of it was I legitimately wanted to spend the rest of my life with him. And I couldn't imagine my life without him. When you're ready for marriage, when you know you're ready to marry, it's with someone that you know you want to spend your life with, that loves you the same way as you love them. Someone that respects you, that allows you to be who you are and not try to change who you are. Someone who is your equal, someone who is your best friend. I don't know how else to explain that.
How do you know when someone loves you?
They give their time to you.
they give their effort to you, and they try to make you happy.
My next question is, if you're in a bad mood, do you prefer to be left alone or have someone to cheer you up?
Who would be the person to cheer me up?
Basically, would you rather be left alone or would you want someone around to cheer you up?
Well, in my case, I do want someone to cheer me up, but usually I do need a rest period where I can relax for a little while to get my head straight.
Okay. When was the last time you broke someone's heart?
I think it was Hillary Pugh and Cliff Jumper. I didn't want it to go down the way it did. And I know I broke their hearts. And I'm very sorry about that.
Is this something that you'd want to talk about or just go on?
Well, the thing is like, I didn't like how they were treating... I know this sounds weird. I didn't like how they were treating G-Man. And... you know, I made some videos referencing them. I didn't want to abandon my friendship with them. And then they kind of, for some reason, they thought that I was only friends with them because of me trying to convert them to Christianity. That's not true. I legitimately love these people. And, because of those couple videos, I did break their heart, and after that, Cliff Jumper, he's just been angry since then, and it's broke my heart, too.
You believe that if people truly care about you, they'll figure out a way to forgive you?
I think they still care. I think for the most part, they have forgiven me. I just don't think they trust me. And I understand. And I accept it.
Okay. Did you ever write a journal?
Well, I have. Well, no. I take YouTube really more as my journal.
Okay. What are you the most thankful for?
My family. My husband and my children still being with me after all the craziness I put them through. I'm grateful I still have them in my life.
Okay. What's the one thing that people always seem to misunderstand about you?
Well, I think a lot of people think I'm a hateful person because I'm loud and boisterous and I get very passionate and loud, and I don't hate anyone. You know, when I'm mad at someone, I get loud and passionate, but I don't hate them. Like right now I'm going through something with G-Man. I don't hate him. I love him. I just wish he would stop with the antics, and he's not getting it, and he uses excuses, and it's just like, I just want to love you, man, and I want you to love me back, and I want you to share love with others, and I don't think that's such a hard thing to ask, especially when you're speaking to a Christian. Shut up, Larry. Sorry. Mm-hmm. That's Facebook.
Mm-hmm. Just seeing if you want to work on that over there real quick.
No, it's fine.
Okay. What is the craziest thing that you have ever done, and would you do it again?
Probably, and no, I wouldn't do it again. Probably having sex in a graveyard.
You had sex in a graveyard?
Oh, yeah. I told you I was a wicked person in my past.
And you're saying you'd do it again?
No, I wouldn't, man. That, I mean, I'm not like that like I used to be anymore.
Well, that was the question. What's the craziest thing you've ever done, and would you do it again? I guess.
Would you? The craziest thing I would do again?
Well, I mean, I kind of let there be some lenience. What's the craziest thing you've ever done, and would you do it again? So if you're like, no, I wouldn't do it again, that's fine.
Yeah, I wouldn't do it again.
All right. Well, I got to, people are going to wonder, obviously, why a graveyard, and how can one possibly get turned on in a place like that? And please tell me the partner was living.
Yes, he was living. I don't know. Me and him, we had a lot of car sex, and this is an ex-fiance back when I was 18, and I don't know. Just one day, he was like, "Hey, let's go here," and I'm like, "All right." So I tried it out, and you know, it was fine, I guess, but I wouldn't do it again because I think it's disrespectful. But when you're young and stupid, you do stupid things like that.
All right. What do you think about when you're by yourself?
What do I think about? Usually my husband. When I'm out by myself, I think about him.
Okay, I gotta ask you something because I might have a suggestion for you. I offer some suggestions off and on in my interviews. Are you familiar with a Christian by the name of Jesus Freak?
I love Jesus Freak.
Jesus Freak, he gave me a great piece of advice not too long ago that has really, really helped me out, especially on YouTube. He said, if somebody pisses you off, somebody upsets you, wait 24 hours before you decide to make a video. Wait 24 hours. If you still feel you got to make it after 24 hours, then do so. But give yourself 24 hours to really think about what you're doing. And it's helped me. Maybe it's a good thing that some good advice for yourself.
Oh, I actually do that most of the time. With G-Man, you have to be quick with him because he has a short attention span.
Oh.
So, I mean, I'm not angry at him. I'm frustrated at him more than angry. But you know, I'm trying to get him in the right spot and not being so hateful to everyone all the time.
Why do you think it seems like he was a lot more gentler and nicer in the beginning? Why do you think he's gotten so rough?
His ego. I think the subscriber count has gotten to his head. I also think I think he's battle-worn, and he has these really funky ideas in his head about certain people, and, you know, I don't know. What do you think about G-Man? Why he's gotten so worse?
I know that I used to get along with him quite a bit in the past. He seemed like a really gentle, laid-back type of guy. Ever since I managed to get him on the Drunken Peasants, he and his views went up. He doesn't seem to have any room for me in his life.
It's weird. I don't know when it comes to him.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure that sooner or later you guys get along. Anytime I ever heard him mention you, he had nothing but nice things to say.
I love Gary. I do. But, you know, he needs to quit trying to
stir the pot and trying to make people purposely mad for views. It's not right.
I'm going to ask you a weird question about this, and then I'll move on to something a little bit more positive. Do you think he's doing it for God anymore, or him? Got to be honest.
I don't think he's doing it for God. Go look at his mark for God. He has that monetized right now. He's monetizing his stuff. He's asking for money from people. I mean, I have no problem with people making money off YouTube. Mm-hmm. But when you put God in the equation of making money for YouTube, that's when you have a problem. When all you're doing is trying to start some kind of drama or strife with people just so you can get the views, just so you can get the AdSense pay. That's where I have a problem with it. He's not doing it for God anymore. He's doing it for, God knows what. I mean, it's sad that he has to go down that level.
I think that some people, they're having a hard time in their life, and finally they have some kind of ability where they might be able to live a little bit more comfortable. I can't blame people like that. But as long as they keep God in their focus, I think that people should have great blessings happen to them. Just saying.
No, I agree.
All right, got a good question for you. If a genie granted you 3 wishes right now, what would you wish for? Now remember, it can be anything. You can play pool with the planets if you want to.
If I had 3 wishes, what would I wish for? Well, the first one has to be money. Who wouldn't wish for money? Second one, fix G-Man. That'll be my second one.
Are you sure you want to do a wish on that? Because that's something you could probably fix in about an hour. You want to blow a wish on it?
I've spent 3 years on that man trying to fix him. I'll let the genie try to do it. I don't think it might work, but we'll see. Third wish. To get my Keiko back, my cat.
If you could live on a big old ranch and have as many cats as you could possibly want, would you do it?
Absolutely. I'd love to be a cat breeder.
Why do you think cats are so awesome?
I guess I understand them. I understand that they can be alone and be fine by themselves, but also, they like being social at the same time. You know, I don't know. They're soft and they love you. But yeah, at the same time, they're not like constantly trying to get your attention like a dog would.
They love you whenever you're ready for it.
Or when they're ready for it, more like.
All right, go ahead and promote your YouTube channel and plug anything that you're wanting out there, whether it be Twitter or Facebook.
Okay, I'm on Twitter as Shanny4Christ, Shanny4Christ on Twitter, and on YouTube. I do multiple things on my YouTube channel. I do face mask vlogs where, you know, I use a face mask and I just talk about random things. So am a professional rambler, and I ramble about random things
all the time. I also talk about Christ, of course, and God, and my experiences with God. I also correct people on my YouTube page, so you'll see a little drama here and there on it. Yeah, I think that's it with my page. If you want to subscribe to me, you can. If not, that's okay, too. at least check me out, see how I am. I don't know. I might be entertaining, I might not be, I don't know. Depends on the person, I guess. You either really love me or you really hate me, so.
All right, Shanny. Well, make sure that you don't become a stranger, whether you're sad or happy. You can come to me anytime and talk to me. Just remember, I'm no saint, never claimed to be, and I might disappoint you, but I'll always care. Just remember that. All right. That.
Thank you, Brett.
Enjoyable having you on the interview.
Oh, thanks.
And try to get
Thank
it up
you for the interview. I didn't expect that today.
Good times.
Yeah, good times.
There is one more thing I got for you. Is there anybody that you think would be interesting in the future to interview? And it can't be a cannibal or a necrophiliac.
Okay. Interview J.D. Kane.
J.D. Kane. Oof, that's rough. All right. Well, I'll put the message out there and see what happens. All right.
All right. All right.
Getting me into trouble.
All right. I am going to get you in trouble, but I think it would be a very interesting talk.
Okay.
My name is Dawn Keane. Please check out our new channel, God TV Radio International Network. Also, check out our gaming channel, Games You Love. You can follow us on Google+, Twitter, and Facebook. Links are in the description. Please don't forget to subscribe, comment, and rate. Have a good day.